George Blaha, and this is the From Glory Days show, which chronicles the lives of professional Detroit athletes following their pro sports careers. Watch the stories unfold as former Detroit Pistons, Tigers, Red Wings, and Lions share their personal stories of struggle and success as they have transitioned from the pinnacle of their pro sports careers back into normal everyday lives. You won't find another show like the From Glory Days show capturing this transition as told directly by the athletes themselves.
Hi, I'm Jeff Ivory, the financial pro featured on the PBS series From Glory Days. Keep an eye out for my financial tip during today's show, and feel free to visit my website for more information and tips on staying financially fit.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help? Hello, I'm Kurt David, author of the book From Glory Days and your host of the show. Today's guest was an All-American at Flint Northern High School. He went on to become a three-time All-American at Michigan State University and was twice awarded a Player of the Year of the Big Ten Conference. Our guest topped his college career with a national championship in the year 2000 and then became a first-round draft pick by the Detroit Pistons, launching an eight-year professional career. Let's give a nice warm welcome to our guest, Mateen Cleaves. Hey, great having you on the show here. We have a special location shooting that we're doing here, the Volunteers of America Veterans Housing Program here in Lansing, Michigan. And at some point in your life, you made a decision to come to Lansing. Why Michigan State University?
Oh, well, I always say this is where my heart was. I got recruited by a lot of schools and a lot of coaches throughout the country. And this is where I always wanted to go. I was a big fan of, Magic Johnson. I heard about all the stories. I didn't really see many games because I was a kid. But Steve Smith was one of my favorite players of all time. And Michigan State just is where my heart was, and I'm thankful that I made that decision.
Yeah, obviously a lot of great memories. I mean, great accomplishments here at Michigan State. What were some of the best memories that you had here while playing?
Well, probably my best memories was in 1998 when we first won the first Big Ten championship. And because we were coming off going into the NIT the year before, mm-hmm. So that was a big thing for me. Then the next year, when going to the Final Four, it kept getting better. Won the Big Ten again, went to the Final Four. And then that following year, we won a national championship. And I tell you, as a kid, that's what you dream about. Those are the jump shots you make at the park, the last second shots you make in the driveway. And to actually sit there and be that last team there when one shining moment came on just was a great feeling and a dream come true.
Only one team finishes on a victory at the end of the year.
Exactly.
So what was that like for you, being at that top of the heap there, top of the national championship there? What did that mean to you?
Well, it just meant a lot because coaches always would say, leave your footprint in the sand. And what better way to do that than win a national championship? And like I say, you dream about those games and you talk about it, but to actually live it in the way we won a national championship, that was the best because we did it as a team. It wasn't just me. It wasn't Mo Pete. It wasn't Jason Richardson. We did it as a team. And that was from the assistant coaches to the trainers to the walk-ons to every guy on that team has something to do with us winning the championship.
Any challenges getting up to that point?
Nah. I don't want to sound too cocky, but when I decided to come back my senior year, our whole goal was to win a national championship. Mm-hmm. And we had some challenges. I mean, we had to beat Wisconsin four times that year. Very tough team. We were down to Iowa State as well as Syracuse, and then it helped us out because the game was at the Palace. So we kind of fed off the crowd. So we did have some challenges, and it was tough for us, but we found a way to get it done. And sitting here, years later, still happy.
Yeah. At what point did you know that professional sports was going to be an option for you?
I probably would say probably my sophomore year of college, mm-hmm. and that's when I became the Big Ten Player of the Year and became an All-American. Mm-hmm. I was an All-American in high school, and I played with Kobe Bryant and those type of guys, but they were so much above us, the other guys. But I really realized in my sophomore year, I really saw the light, when I made the All-American team with the likes of Vince Carter, Mike Bibby, and those guys. And to see those guys going to the draft and get drafted, that kind of gave me a go.
Realization you could be there as well.
Exactly.
In fact, is that true that you're the only Michigan State player ever to be a three-time All-American? Is that correct?
It is. And what an honor. Because look at all the players, the great players that I've come through Michigan State. So to sit there and to be a three-time All-American, it was great for me.
Yeah, and so you saw the pro sports on the horizon. Tell us about that draft. Tell us, what was it like coming back home, basically, or never leaving home, so to speak?
Man, I was floating on cloud nine. I mean, you win a national championship, and then the next few months later, you get drafted by Detroit Pistons, my hometown team. I mean, you're talking tradition. You're talking Bad Boy. You're talking Isaiah Thomas, Rick Mahorn, John Sally, Joe Dumars, Bill Laimbeer. I mean, Dennis Rodman, Chuck Daly, the coach. You're talking all this tradition. I grew up watching this, and to get drafted, I mean, I tell you, I was on cloud nine, and it was the best feeling in the world.
And then when you got there, any starry eyes or anything like that when you got there as far as seeing some of those players and people?
My press conference, after I got drafted, I had to come back to Detroit and go to a press conference, and Joe Dumars was there. So I was like, wow. And to talk to Joe, it was so surreal. But, once training camp started, I was there with Jerry Stackhouse. He was our best player at the time. And another veteran, Mike Curry, that took me mm-hmm. under his wing. So it was great to be around those guys. But I was very big-eyed to be able to pass the ball to Jerry Stackhouse. Mm-hmm.
So what was it like during the time as far as playing? I mean, you came off a national championship, obviously the top of the college game. What about playing for the Pistons at that time?
Well, it was a lot of pressure. It was a lot of pressure because I was the hometown guy. And, I got drafted the 14th pick. And it was like, okay, here's a guy that's going to take us to the next level. And we had a rough year. And it was a kind of an up and down year. Mm-hmm. I had a brother who was murdered, so it was tough to deal with that year, and then and as well as being a rookie and just going through those challenges. So it was a tough year for me, but I ended up making the rookie All-Star game, which was fun to be a part of the All-Star weekend. That was great. And, I met a bunch of people, and I had great times. It was ups and downs, but I tell you, I wouldn't change a thing.
So you stayed with it. I mean, that tenacity is it. I mean, you come up from the national championship, you're top of the heap. You get some challenges that year coming in as a Piston, the personal losses as well as far as your brother and having to deal with that while still being a professional and playing. What kept you going?
Well, I tell you, my mom. I had great family. I had great family structure around me. And my mother and father, she just kept me pushing. She was so strong. When I saw how she dealt with my brother's death and her adversity through her life, that just kept me pushing. And coming from Flint, Michigan, I mean, just to come out of Flint, that's just something we do. Something you kind of learn how to deal with adversity and learn how to find your way and make a way. And I just reverted back to my days back in Flint, Michigan. And hey, live your dream. No need to sulk and be sad. You're in the NBA. You're living out your dream. And that's the kind of attitude that I took too.
What'd you do to handle that pressure?
Actually, just play ball. I just did whatever I could do. Certain things I couldn't handle. I couldn't handle my playing time. I couldn't control that. That was mm-hmm. the coach's job. My thing was to go out and just have fun. And at first, I put a lot of pressure on myself. I was a guy that got the Magic Johnson feel of the game. I smiled. I mm-hmm. enjoyed myself, the high fives. And when I first got there, I wasn't doing that. It was a lot of pressure. And I was putting so much pressure on
yourself
myself.
Is what you said. Yeah.
And then I just got away from that, and I started having fun again. And that's how I dealt with it. Went out there, I played the game that I love, and I had fun doing it.
And you played 6 years in the NBA, a couple years overseas, so yeah. About 8 years total. As far as at what point did you start realizing that it wasn't as fun anymore?
Well, after playing, I played in Athens, Greece. I loved it, on vacation, had a good time, got paid for going to a beautiful place. I was in Russia. Didn't like Russia as well. And, I played in the minor leagues a few months. And mm-hmm. then once I wasn't getting out of it what I was putting into it. Mm. And I figured that, hey, maybe it's time to move on and do something else. And I took a challenge because everyone just thinks that you're just a basketball player. That's mm-hmm. all you're going to be able to do. So I took offense to that, and I wanted to just venture off into something else. I really didn't know what that would be at the time, but I didn't want to just keep dragging. I had a few injuries. I didn't want to keep dragging my legs around mm-hmm. and keep pounding my body. I just didn't feel that I was getting out of it what I put into it. So that it was kind of a easy decision at that point to stop playing.
Was it? You mentioned that you were loving the game, and that's what kept you excited about it. But did you stop loving it as much as far as a player?
Yeah, I was losing the love for the game. And like I told you, I was a happy camper. Mm-hmm. Whenever I was on the basketball floor, I was in heaven. I had a great time. I enjoyed it. It was like being at a party. Mm-hmm. And I stopped. I was injured and being traded and being cut and traveling and going overseas. It just, like I said, I just didn't have that same love. And if I knew I didn't have that love for it, if I didn't have that same energy, then it was time for me to step away.
Was it a moment that you realized you were done with basketball as a player?
I think, I would say when I was probably my last year was like 06, 07, I just felt, like I said, I just didn't have the love for it. I went to Denver Nuggets training camp, which I played great, and I got cut. And the coaches were telling me, well, it's the business of it. Well, you know, it's the business, and you play good enough to win. I mean, good enough to make the team, but it's the business part of it. And at that point, I would say, hey, well, I just don't want to deal with the business part of it no more. And whenever you're not good, if they're telling you play good and you still get cut, that was my time to walk away.
Yeah, and so then what? I mean, what was that like walking away from something you love and were a part of for so long? I mean, as far as a player, that's your, I don't want to say it's your identity, but certainly it's a big part of it. Since a kid, you love the game, you played a game in Flint, here at Michigan State, in the pros. What was that like to be able to know that I can no longer get paid for this job, I have to move on with my life? How was that emotionally?
It was tough, and it was hard to deal with. It was hard to even look at myself in the mirror because I was always taught fight through adversity, play through injuries, and I felt that I was giving up. I felt that I was giving up at times, but then sitting down, talking to my mother, talking to my wife, which was my girlfriend at the time, which is my wife now, talking to them, it's like they was like, hey, do what you do. You know, go with how you feel. And so for that, at that point, I left it alone, and I didn't feel bad about it. You know, I didn't feel like I was giving up. I just took the time, you know, and really put thought into it. And when I walked away, it was like closing that book, and it was like, hey, I'm never looking back. I'm done playing. It's time to move forward.
Did you let it go right away, you think?
I actually did. I let it go right away. I mean, I stopped playing pickup ball. I stopped everything, and it was different because my life was basketball my whole life. From day one, you was on the schedule. It was basketball, this basketball, school, basketball, everything. So it was definitely different for me. But, you know, for me, I just kind of found the strength to move on.
Do you play at all anymore? As far as you mentioned, you stopped playing. Are you done totally playing as far as?
I stopped playing, then I tried to come back and play again. I was playing at the YMCA, and it got kind of physical again, and I ended up tearing my quad muscle. And had to end up getting surgery on that. So that's been like a year and a half, 2 years I haven't played.
And that's when you look at it and say, boy, is it even worth it for me just to pick up a ball anymore as far as you start having the injuries and things of that sort. I mean, you had a good run at it. You know, one of the things that I realize as a former player and now with the show and the book and everything is that professional athletes take a 90, 95% pay cut when they're done playing. What kind of challenges, if any, did you have as a result of your transition?
Man, stop spending money. You know, it was tough. That was the toughest part for me because for years, you're able to go and buy what you want. Go to any car dealership, pick out any car you want. So go to the mall and buy anything you want. So it was the toughest part for me was to kind of budget, to put myself on a budget. And that definitely was tough, but I just had to do it.
No. Well, we're going to take a break right now for educational minute. But when we come back, more from Mateen Cleaves and his transition out of pro sports.
Thinking about our finances can be frustrating, can it? I mean, there's trusts, stocks and bonds, annuities, life insurance, disability insurance, health care, taxes. Whew, it can really get overwhelming. And professionals in the financial services industry don't always make it any easier. With our complex financial strategies, expensive life insurance options, countless spreadsheets, it's not easy at all. But when you think about it, isn't finance mostly common sense? Don't spend more than you earn. Save your money and invest it prudently. Diversify and invest only in those things that you understand. Buy low, sell high. Common sense. So my tip for you is simple. Sit down for a minute and write out your most basic financial goals on paper. Then apply common sense to determine if those goals are achievable. Armed with that little bit of information, you can tackle finances much easier.
I'm Kurt David, back with our guest, Mateen Cleaves. When we left before the break, we started talking about that life after pro sports, the emotional, the financial. What, looking back on it, what were probably the biggest challenges for you?
Well, I think, like I said, definitely spending, you know, budgeting my money and everything. And then actually finding out what I wanted to do. And I never thought about that. And I went through tons of seminars where people say, well, your day is going to come when you're done playing. And you're young and you never put thought into it. And one of my good friends, which is my manager now, Willa Cooper, she came over. We went out to have lunch. And she said, so what are you going to do? And I was like, well, I don't know. I really don't know what I'm going to do. So it was kind of a reality check.
Yeah.
She kind of asked me what I, and I didn't really know what I wanted to do.
You couldn't have an answer for that.
I didn't have an answer for
it. How long did it take you before you had an answer?
Man, weeks, because she stayed on me. You know, she was a good friend of mine, and she stayed on me constantly. Like, what you going to do? What you going to do? And I always was, my easy answer was help kids. I want to help kids. You know, she's like, okay, well, how do you want to help kids? How are you going to bring in income as well as help kids? And so, and you got a family. You got to take care of your family. So that's she stayed on me constantly.
So she helped you get focused again as far as what is it that you're going to do. So at some point you made a decision. And what did you decide to do?
Well, you know, definitely my thing was to help kids. And, you know, I started doing programs with the Boys and Girls Clubs, the book reading clubs. I always gave a basketball camp, 500 kids every year, because I knew when I came up I didn't have the money to go to camp. So I would give a free camp. We'll get 500
and where,
kids.
Where do you do the camp, the
Flint
free
Northern
camp?
High School. I would do it where I played high school basketball at, and in my college, in my hometown community. And I would do that. And one day I started watching broadcasting. I started watching basketball games, and I kind of took a liking to broadcasting. And I said, well, maybe I might try that. You know, I thought about it, but I still really didn't know what I wanted to do. And I went to Curtis Granderson. He had an all-star game, a little celebrity basketball game. And Fox Sports Detroit was there. And they said, they didn't know I was done playing. And they asked me to come on, you know, and to try it out. And at first I said, nah, because I really wasn't sure of myself. And then I went on and had a couple practice takes. And it was like, a few days later, it was like 3-2-1, you're on live. that was bad.
Did you feel prepared or no?
Oh, I was not prepared because I didn't know nothing about it. I didn't understand. I thought you could just get up there and talk about basketball. I didn't understand the preparation you had to put into it. I didn't understand how to change from camera to look in this camera, the earpiece in your ear, the cameraman saying, look at this camera instead of that camera. And then that whole time, the producer saying, wrap it up. So it was a big challenge for me. And I would go home and practice looking in the mirror and doing stuff like that, but it was a challenge for me, and it's still a challenge to this day.
Was it all basketball you were doing as far as when you got into the broadcasting? All basketball? Any other sports or anything?
Yeah,
like that?
It was all basketball.
Did you have any issues with when you were watching or when you're broadcasting, thinking about the game, thinking about, boy, you know, I wish I was out there, anything like that at all?
Well, I didn't have those issues, but one thing I had to defer from was talking basketball with my friends. In broadcasting and broadcasting it to the world, it's a difference. You know, it's a difference when you're talking to your friend and giving points, you know, looking into a camera. So that's the stuff that I had to get used to.
What was different about it for you?
Well, you know, when you're talking to your friends, you kind of kick back, you lay back. You don't have to watch your language. You know, you can say any and everything. And then it was like, I caught myself I was putting too much thought into it. I wanted to have every answer to be just this great answer. And once I just started kicking back and relaxing and being myself, and that came from going home, watching tape, which I learned from basketball. You know, you play basketball, you watch the film, you break it down, and that's how you learn from your mistakes. And I would go home and watch the tapes, and it was brutal. I mean, my wife would sit there, and she'd say, oh, that was bad, you know. And then I would sit in front of the mirror, and I would have her ask me questions, and I would answer them looking in the mirror like as if I was looking into a camera. So it took time. It took a lot of time, but, you know, I started to get it.
Any mentors or anybody that you watched or that you learned from, you think?
Oh, I watched some of my Spartans. You know, I watched Steve Smith was in it. Eric Snow was doing it. Magic Johnson was doing it. Chris Webber, which I played with in Sacramento, who's like a big brother to me, he was doing it. And so I would pick up the phone and call these guys and get a lot of advice on it. And the best advice that I got was from Chris Webber when he said, why do people like you? I said, you know, cool, kind of cool guy, got a nice personality. He said, well, let that out. You know, let your personality out and just be yourself. He said, if they fire you, get fired being yourself. Don't get fired trying to be nobody else. They can go get just the regular Joe. Be Mateen Cleaves. People want to see the personality. So that was the best advice that I had.
No, that makes sense. And that's what you're known for. And one of the things that you're known for as well is giving back. You know, you're a community guy. You talked about the Flint Northern basketball camps. You still do. You also have a foundation. Let's talk about that foundation.
Yes, it's an outreach foundation, and I named it after my mother. It's the Francis Cleaves Community Outreach Foundation. And I wanted to do something because my mother, she set the tone. You know, when I was a kid, she always was out in the community doing things for people. She was always, she was a neighborhood mother. People didn't have parents that were able to go up to the schools and parent-teacher conferences. She always did that. And she always did whatever she can do to help the community. So that's something that I wanted to do. You know, basketball opened up doors and gave me different connections. So now I use those connections. The people that I, you know, when I was playing with, when I was with Nike and Gatorade and some of these other companies. I call on these people, and the relationships that I made, they come back and they help me and help me in my community. So I just like to give back. I do a lot of stuff with the Boys and Girls Club. I go to all the regular communities, centers, the activity centers that we have in the city, and just hang out with the kids sometimes. It's not going in there. It's not playing basketball. Sometimes it's just hanging out, interacting with the kids, mm-hmm. because that's something that I wish I would have had an opportunity to do when I was a kid, to interact with a guy that made it, you know, that we looked up to in our community.
That's had some accomplishments as a basketball player, but now, you know, after basketball as well, you're having some success and giving back to the community. Well, you know, you mentioned about your mother. Obviously, she was a strong fixture in your life.
Oh, man, strong. You know, she was at her funeral. I told my father, no disrespect to you, but I think I got my strength from my mother. And I tell you, she was so strong, and she was a smaller lady, but she kept us in line. She got four or five boys, and she kept us all in line. She did a great job with us. And I tell you, I got my fight and my toughness from my mother, and I just saw her persevere over years, find a way to make it, find a way to put food on the table for us, and find a way to do for us. And that's something I just took a liking to, and then I got all my toughness from my mom.
And what a way to honor her with the foundation as well as what you're doing now with that. But as far as, you know, coming out of pro sports as a player, to back up to that, was there anything good about being done with playing basketball?
Well, it was cool. I take just to be a regular Joe. And it was cool just to hang out with my nieces and nephews, be able to go watch them play, interact in their sports, be able to go to school plays, be able to take them to movies, be able to have sleepovers at my house. You know, never, because when you're playing, you're always on the go.
Right.
And it was
having time on your hands.
Yeah, definitely. You don't have time on your hands. So just having that time to interact and do things with my family, that's, I took full advantage of it.
Oh, well, speaking of time, this is one of my favorite times of the show where we have question and answer from our live studio audience. In this case, some of our veterans as well. Are you ready to take some questions?
Let's get it going. Yeah.
My question to you, Mateen, is during the national championship game, you had that ankle injury. We all thought you weren't going to come back. How were you able to overcome that adversity?
Well, I tell you, it was actually easy to overcome it. When you're playing in a national championship game, and that's what you play the game for, that's why I came back my senior season to win a national championship. Those were all the years I dribbled up and down the street and played basketball. So it was actually easy to come back because I didn't want to let my team down. And, you know, they actually carried me. I got a lot of credit for coming back, but the team actually carried me, and I'm glad we were able to win.
Well, let's take another question.
You being a point guard, who would be the other four all-time great Spartans you would love to play with?
Wow, that's a good question.
Yeah.
Well, you got to say Magic Johnson.
Okay.
Steve Smith was one of my favorite all-time. I looked up to.
Yeah.
Greg Kelser, because he'd catch alley-oops and I could throw them.
Okay, okay.
And... Man, I don't want to leave. No, it's hard because I want to play with everybody. But I would say Jay Vinson.
Jay Vinson.
He had a smooth game, man.
Okay.
You notice I pick guys that make me look good.
that's a dream team right there.
Let's take another question here.
What advice would you give to returning soldiers and their families for their own adversity and injuries that they may be suffering from?
I got nothing but the utmost respect for the veterans and what they've done, you know, for our country. You know, I mean, people come up to us and ask us for autographs and stuff like that, and the real true heroes are the veterans. So let me say that. And my advice would be just to try to stay positive, look forward, you know, continue to lean on people. Don't hold everything inside, lean on people, talk, and just keep looking forward and pushing positive, because you are well-respected, and everything will be all right. Just keep looking forward and try to stay positive.
Mateen, if we could, I'd like you to pass on something else at this point. This show is about the transition of professional athletes, but we want it to be more. As we have this special episode here at the Volunteers of America Veterans Housing Program in Lansing, we want to take it beyond professional athletes and also talk about the veterans and anybody that's in transition. What advice would you have for anybody that's facing a transition or change in adversity? What would be the advice?
Well, first of all, I would say get a plan. You got to have a plan. You got to have a plan. Second of all, believe in yourself. And whatever it is you want to do, you got to believe in yourself. And third of all, whatever you did to become successful, and the first thing that you did, mm-hmm. What you're going into, the next thing you're going into, put that same energy and that same drive into that. You know that, that you got. You know the blueprint because you were successful before. So put that same energy, that same belief, and that same drive into your new arena, and I guarantee you will be successful because you already know the blueprint.
Great advice.
Thank you.
Well, I'm Kurt David, and this wraps up another show. I'd like to thank our guest, Mateen Cleaves, for joining us. Please join us next time when we watch the stories of professional athletes unfold from Glory Days.
Hi again. I'm Jeff Ivory, and I hope you enjoyed today's show and the educational minute I shared with you. If you'd like more information on staying financially fit through your life's transitions, please visit my website at jwifinancial.com.
This program is made possible by...
Who are we? We're the Volunteers of America. What do we do? Since 1896, we've been serving men, women, children, seniors, and veterans right here in Michigan with shelter, housing, food, and much more. Need help? Want to help?